And I think, you know, we have nearly now a full house. So let me join you in the joy of listening to a fabulous speaker on a subject that is gaining a very serious currency these days. And the subject, of course, is algorithmic trading. And we are very happy to have found a speaker right amongst us here in Bombay who has a global markets exposure, who has done it hands-on for close to 10 years. He comes with impeccable credentials, with a graduation and a post-graduation in engineering from the IIT. And on top of all of it, you know, what I have found and got floored with completely in a small personal interaction with him, that with knowledge as immense as he holds, and an experience as valuable as he holds, he is as humble intellectually as well as at a personal level. And that is something, you know, which is something I find really very, very affable. So please join me, ladies and gentlemen, in welcoming our illustrious speaker of the day, Mr. Manish Jalan.
And a very good afternoon to all of you out here. Let me begin this session on algorithmic trading with a very interesting 8th class biology workbook. If you know, in 8th class biology, Mr. Charles Darwin says a very interesting phrase. He says that in the long run, the species which actually survive is not the species which is the fastest or the strongest. It is basically the species which can adapt to the changes. Right, and that's basically exactly why we are here. Our markets, equity markets, commodity markets, currency markets, they all change so fast, so dramatically, that if we don't adapt to the changes which is really happening in this particular market, we'll not be able to survive. Right? To give you an example, I mean, if you look at the history of the Indian equity market, we started with the first exchange being the Bombay Stock Exchange. Then came the National Stock Exchange way back in 1990s, and the moment NSE was there, people started doing spread trading. You know, the spread between BSE and NSE used to be like 4, 4.5, 5%, and it was an easy money to be made, right? As and when the liquidity started rising in both the markets, the opportunity just stopped arising, and the opportunity just kept on vanishing. From there on, the market progressed further. If you look at it, 2000, NSE introduced Nifty futures, right, and stock futures. And then basically what happened was there was a huge parity between the cash and the future. So people started doing cash future arbitrage. There was a parity of 2, 2.5, 3, 4% between the cash and the future. And people would make 24%, 25%, 30% return annualized, which used to be risk-free. Now, as and when more and more computers, more and more algorithms started coming into the picture, the difference between the cash and the future started shrinking off, right? The rapid changes then came in 2001 to 2007, when basically we had this huge bull run. And any single market analyst, any single technical analyst who would be there with a long call on the market would always be right, right? Come again in 2008 and you see all of that perishing away. BSE, NSE arbitrage, you do today, you won't make any money. You do a cash future arbitrage, you'll make less than 12% return, right, which is not even good as compared to what you could put into the bank and basically get out of it. You do a long only call, you don't know when the market is basically going to have a 500 point fall, and your calls would completely go wrong, right? After 2008, there has been a very dramatic change in any kind of analysis or any kind of equity market that we really have been in. Now, when I was in 2008, I was in Japan. I was working with Merrill Lynch. And you know, you see these huge red figures every single day, Lehman crashing off, you know, Merrill Lynch almost filing for bankruptcy. And you know, none of the investment banks, none of the hedge funds globally are actually willing to even listen to your job calls, right? All of a sudden, I started observing that there's a sea of change which is happening. And I was getting a lot of job calls at that point in time. And I was quite surprised. I mean, if you look at the equity market, it's going down by 50%. Investment banks are laying off left, right, and center. Who are these guys giving job calls? And I suddenly realized that there's a new sea of guys which are coming up from high frequency trading, right, which were giving calls left, right, and center and trying to recruit people. In 2008 itself, high frequency trading firms in US made more than $21 billion when all the other firms are actually losing money. Today in US, the top 2% of the high frequency trading firm catapults for more than 67% of the US volumes. right? Now look at the amount of the volume and the liquidity which is being generated in the US by these high frequency traders, right? Now that is the kind of sea of change which has happened already in the US, and it's slowly propagating towards the European and the Asian markets. Today in Europe, about 40 to 45% of the volumes in the exchange happen through high frequency and algorithmic trading. And in Asia today, ex-Japan, about 15% of the trading happens through high frequency. And we are seeing these changes, you know, happening every single day, right? And that's the reason why basically, you know, we see this huge gathering here, is because there's a sea of change which is happening and we need to adapt to that change. And that's the reason why, you know, the Darwinian theory holds the most at this particular point, at least in the equity market or in the market context, right? Now let's go to the next phase. Right, now what happens is whenever I go and give these talks on algorithmic trading, and whenever I talk about algorithmic trading, most people tend to get confused. They think that algorithmic trading is probably only high frequency trading. There are people who are there still in Hong Kong and Singapore who think that algorithmic trading is only a VWAP or a TWAP engine. Right, I'll explain to you what a VWAP and a TWAP engine is, but to basically, you know, make sure that people sort of understand what an algorithmic trading per se means, is that any kind of a rule-based system, any kind of a system which has been repeatedly tested and tested over and over again, you know, thoroughly back-tested, has seen all sorts of market patterns and existing today to basically trade whenever that market pattern occurs again, over and over again, is a form of an algorithmic trading. Right, the broad classification of algorithmic trading, you know, just like any other trading, can be done into two separate phases. One is basically the prop trading and the other is the agency trading. Now I'm sure that most of the people who are sitting here in the audience would be very familiar with the prop trading, which is basically, you know, you would be doing a technical trend following system, you would be doing a pair trading, you would be doing an index arbitrage, you know, all of these forms of trading are basically on the prop side. But an equally important context, which basically comes from an algorithmic trading, is also on the execution side. Today, the large investment banks like a Goldman Sachs or a Morgan Stanley or a Credit Suisse, they basically don't make, you know, I'm not talking about Goldman Sachs, but most of these investment banks on the algorithmic trading front don't really make, you know, a lot of money only on the prop side, but they make an equal amount of money on the agency side also. So for example, tomorrow, if you have a large mutual fund like a Fidelity, right, and they want to buy, say, $200 million worth of Google, right, they would punch that particular order into probably a Credit Suisse or the JP Morgan engine, and the engine would break down this large chunk of order into small slices and send to the market such that the market prices are not impacted, right? That is basically an agency-based execution algorithm, right? So as much as algorithmic trading is about the prop side, it is also about the agency side, right? And it can be applied into any given context because all the contexts in the market ultimately follows rules, right? So that's basically on the...
Is the sound okay?
Right. So let's try and understand an algorithmic trading in a very, very simple context. What is exactly an algorithm? A dictionary definition of an algorithm is just, it's a set of simple rules. Right? Now, rules is something which can be followed both by human beings as well as computers. We have been following rules all our life, starting from the day one that we were born. You know, mother taught us what to do XYZ, father taught us XYZ. When we go to the school, teacher teaches us something, you know, to be in the class at a regular interval. We have been following rules all throughout. And today, when we are in the market, we again follow rules, right? I mean, I basically would not be the right judge, but I'm sure people sitting here knows technical analysis much, much more than what I basically do. And I'm sure that everybody who's actually doing technical analysis here understand that technical analysis is nothing but a set of rules. You say a fast moving average is going over a slow moving average, right? And it's crossing over, it's probably a time to buy in that particular stock, right? You basically see in a pair trading that something is spreading out by a two standard deviation, it's probably a time to get into that particular stock. So there are a set of rules. Now the problem with human beings is that our mind is fragmented into two different areas. One is the intelligent side, which is the intelligent question which follows the rules. And the second is the emotion side, the emotional question side. Because of the emotion quotient which all our human beings have, we are always subjected to this greed, fear, you know, the revenge that I need to basically recover all my losses that I have done. If I have made 100% in a year, I probably will make 500% the next year. There's a lot of emotions which keeps creeping into us as and when we do all sorts of technical analysis. And that's the reason why the rules are best followed by the computers. But that's not the holy grail. That's really not the holy grail. If you really look at how basically the algorithmic trading came into the picture, it started way back in 1970s when there were no computers and people still used to do algorithmic trading. One of the best examples of algorithmic trading and probably one of the pioneers is a guy called Sir Richard Dennis. Now Richard Dennis was a guy who basically converted his $1,600 into $200 million within less than 20 years just by following a very simple set of rules. He always used to say one particular thing. He said that, look, great traders are never born, they are always made, right? He had this huge debate about this particular aspect with one of his colleagues called Mr. William Ekrath, who basically used to work with him. Now these two people basically, you know, got into this argument that great traders are never made, they are always born, and Mr. Dennis used to say that the great traders are always made, they are never born. So in order to experiment whether it is really true that the great traders are really made and not really born, what he did was he hired 21 fresh grads from, you know, various universities in US and gave each one of them $1 million each, right? And then he told that, look, I'm going to explain to you a set of very simple rules that you need to follow follow as and when you go ahead. And he explained them a very set of simple rule, which I'll just explain you on the board. So Mr. Dennis told to these 21 fresh grads that all you need to do is every time a commodity or a stock passes through its 20-day high, right, you initiate a buy. Very simple, 20-day high, if a particular commodity or an asset class crosses, you basically go ahead and buy that particular commodity, right? Now, he basically decided something like, I would just call it as a vol limit, you know, so we all know what a volatility of a particular asset class is, right? So he basically said that every time the commodity moves in your favor by 2 times the vol,